Good afternoon. This is a hearing on human rights and water in the Americas, and I thank the petitioners and the state for being here this morning to deal with this very, very life important issue, the issue of water, and for all of us, which we have a right to have potable, drinking, clean water. So, with that, I am not going to take time because we're starting late to introduce myself and the panel. We have our names here, and you have on the website the rapporteurships that we have. So, with that, could I ask the petitioners to start? Thank you. For 20 minutes. 20, less if possible. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of the U.S. Human Rights Network and our national coalition from across the United States, we thank the Commission for this hearing about the current crisis related to the human rights to water and sanitation in the U.S. and for our previous hearing last year on this issue, as well as your recent annual report covering this issue. Our testimony highlights new and continuing situations in rural and urban areas where low-income, indigenous, homeless, undocumented, and black and brown communities are disproportionately impacted by lack of equal access to safe, affordable, and adequate water and sanitation, as well as an emerging set of promising better practices to change this unacceptable reality. This problem includes the impact of extractive industries on the right to water, but encompasses much more. This is about the United States government's denial of the right to life by failure to ensure universal access to safe, affordable, and adequate water and sanitation without discrimination. This is about affordability. Communities being able to afford safe water and sanitation services, communities facing mass water shutoffs because they can't afford water, and then being criminalized for turning their water back on or not having sanitation. This is about contamination. Communities whose water sources are contaminated by agricultural practices, extractive industry operations, industrial processes, munition plants, and military bases, and power generation. We need look no further than the crisis in Flint, Michigan, to understand the critical problems we face in the U.S. This is about infrastructure, including universal access to water and sanitation services for daily human needs, irrespective of income, if you have a home, and if you live in a rural or urban area. You will hear from directly affected people on why this issue requires clear leadership from the federal government. We need constructive dialogue between the U.S. government, civil society, and affected communities to move towards this goal and fulfill the human rights to water and sanitation for all as basic human rights. Thank you.
Yat Dayan, thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is Teresita Kiana of the Redwater Pond Road community of the Navajo Nation in New Mexico. My home is in an area that is located between two abandoned uranium mines and half a mile away from an abandoned uranium mill. As a child, I played at abandoned mine sites. And at the time, we were never told of the dangers of these mines. Now I find my own family suffer health impacts from exposure to uranium-contaminated dust and water. My children have developed sudden allergies, a heart murmur, and low birth weight. My husband has elevated levels of uranium in his body. My grandmother died from pulmonary fibrosis. My husband, EPA needs to clean up our community to background standards and move the waste far away as it is done in non-native communities. Just a few miles from our home, EPA has allowed a proposed uranium mine which uses chemicals to strip uranium from underground water sources. The Navajo Nation stated this will be used for future drinking water. We demand that the U.S. government reconsider this exemption and adopt stricter regulations for all exemptions. Near Milan, New Mexico, the Forest Service is considering a permit for a huge underground uranium mine that would destroy nearby springs and the aquifer that feeds them. Yet the government won't protect our waters. We ask that the government refuse to permit extractive projects on sacred sites or impact cultural important water sources. Indigenous people, working class, and minority communities across New Mexico face increasingly dire threats to their drinking water supplies. It is past time for the U.S. and state government to take our concerns seriously and take action to guarantee our rights to safe water.
Good day. I am Bernice Johnson Howard, Georgia Wands Field Coordinator for the Shell Bluff area in Waynesboro, Georgia. Shell Bluff can be hazardous to health. It has an aging nuclear weapons plant and a nuclear power plant existing in close proximity to this rural, mostly black community. Both nuclear facility contaminants invade our environment. Radiological poisons entering our bodies through the air we must breathe, water we drink, homegrown vegetables by fish, deer, and other animals consume. Nuclear poisons cannot be cleaned from air, rivers, or land. Radiological poisons in our environments will stay in our environments for many thousands of years. Ungodly elements that strip health and livelihoods from thousands of generations. Women and girls are particularly harmed. The National Academy of Sciences research shows women have a 40 to 60% greater chance of getting cancer than men when exposed to same radiation levels. Children's risks are even greater. Girls are 6 times more likely to develop cancer than boys. These are our grandmothers, mothers, daughters, and children. A partial list of nuclear contaminants in our water and environment are tritium, especially damaging to women. It's known to cause miscarriages and birth defects. Plutonium stays in the body for decades, damaging body organs. Plutonium's half-life is 24,000 years. Iodine-129, thyroid cancer. Its half-life is 15 million years. Acceptable dose limit calculations used by nuclear industries often do not calculate how people of color or the elderly absorb radiation. One safe radiation dose fits all is laughable and deadly. The National Academy of Sciences states there are no safe doses of radiation, and every dose of radiation increases cancer risk. Thank you.
Greetings. My name is Dwayne Chiliazzi. I'm a farmer, community leader, and a grandpa. I am from Shiprock, Navajo Nation, New Mexico. This past August, a US EPA contractor breached the abandoned King Gold mine, releasing over 3 million gallons of contamination into our San Juan River, including lead, arsenic, and mercury. Our irrigation water was shut off halfway through our crop season, hurting over 500 farming families. We fell into a state of chaos, devastation, and trauma. It was hard to understand we would not have water for our crops. We felt helpless and angry. We've lost 75% of our crops. As indigenous peoples in the transition between our ancient ways and the modern world, Our reliance on agriculture is more than subsistence and economics. It is a foundation of our culture and our spiritualism, exemplifying our intrinsic relationship with the Earth Mother. We remain apprehensive about using the river water. We must have water to continue our time-honored tradition of farming. This is a grave violation of our human rights to water by US EPA. And we pray the commission to prevail upon the United States to right these wrongs of contaminating our life-giving river. Thank you.
My name is Juan Olivares. I am the president of the Genesee County Hispanic Latino Collaborative in Flint, Michigan. I'm here today to talk about the community everyone has forgotten about in Flint, the undocumented community. Even though hearings have been scheduled and investigations are being made, not one person from the government has included the undocumented community in their investigations to begin the process of immigration relief in the form of certifying U visas for them. Perjury by government officials has led to thousands of undocumented people poisoned with lead. Now, because they do not have status, they do not qualify for health insurance. Being in this country is not a capital punishment crime. However, without the government taking responsibility in helping these people, they are sentencing them to death. Yes, there are free clinics and health centers, but that will never be enough for the treatment that parents and children would need on a long-term basis. Our community members were not asked for documentation to be poisoned, but are not required to prove they are citizens to be eligible for health insurance. Our undocumented communities have lived in fear for the past months for being asked for IDs, legal status to receive water, and for lead testing. Action to help our community should have been taken already. I ask that we no longer ignore the undocumented children, parents, and family members. We do know the effects of lead poisoning, and they are long-term. We need U visas to make sure we protect those exposed, have a long-term shield to make sure they are taken care of and looked after and not swept under the rug. They are human beings, and our undocumented community have the right to health insurance, and they have the human right to water just like everyone else. Thank you.
It is my distinct honor to come before you as a true face.
It is my distinct honor to come before you as a true face of homeless women throughout the country. My name is Kelly Miller, and my homelessness began in my hometown of Paintsville, Kentucky over 4 years ago, where I was unlawfully forced out of my home. I have lived in a homeless shelter here in D.C. for the last 2 years. As a homeless female, the constant demeaning and degrading from society as a whole is burdensome enough, without the added adversity of not being able to perform the basic human function of expelling bodily waste without exposing oneself to the public, or even worse, fearing physical violence or criminal punishment. This same bodily function is performed multiple times daily by every human being, without a second thought or worry as to where to conduct the act, nor experience fear of being raped as they utilize public or private facilities with clean running water. Women must completely expose ourselves to complete this basic need. In our design, women must deal with monthly menstruation, which requires access to clean water to maintain proper hygiene and eliminate infection and discomforting odor. While living in the streets of Kentucky, I wore a skirt at night to hide myself while I performed basic bodily functions. This made me more vulnerable, but it was a risk that I had to take in order to maintain my dignity and not risk being arrested for indecent exposure. When I got to D.C., I assumed I would be able to have safe and sanitary access to running water and restroom facilities. But local businesses here purposefully locked their restrooms, refusing to allow homeless persons to utilize their restrooms unless they purchased their product. I beg of this commission to stand with the homeless and to demand that the U.S. government ensure adequate alternatives so that no individual must be left to experience the humiliation, degradation, and the threat of criminality of being forced to perform basic bodily functions in public. It is simply unacceptable that our country does not provide a safe and sanitary environment for homeless individuals, especially women, to undertake basic bodily functions. I am human. I am of value.
My name is Catherine Coleman Flowers. I'm the founder of the Alabama Center for Rural Enterprise, and I serve on the staff of the Equal Justice Initiative. I am a native of Lowndes County, Alabama, which is between Selma and Montgomery. In 1906, W.E.B. Du Bois assessed the county with this quote, "I do not think it would be easy to find a place where conditions were more unfavorable to the rise of the black man." Despite a history of racial terror and benign neglect, it gave birth to the original Black Panther Party. Currently, it is an example of the starkest form of inequality in the United States, where poor black children are living and playing amongst raw sewage. It is a blatant violation of human rights. People are being charged with being too poor to afford a septic system and are living under the constant threat of being arrested. The Alabama Department of Public Health estimates that up to 90% of households in Lowndes County have inadequate or non-existent septic systems. Traditional septic systems cannot function in our soils, which require installation of much more expensive systems. In addition, the expensive systems also fail, with sewage often flowing back into the home through sinks and bathtubs. The poor in rural Lowndes County are living in third world conditions. Without access to rural infrastructure, the citizens are deprived of their dignity and their health. We seek your help to appeal to the White House to help us identify and employ affordable, sustainable, decentralized technologies so all Americans can have access to sanitation. Thank you.
My name is Horacio Mesquita. I live in a farm worker community in California. In 1990, the synthetic fertilizers and pesticides in our water make us sick. The county tried to evict us, but attorneys helped us to keep our homes. We then got the county to install a new well with good water, but the cost went up 500%. Many of us now pay over 15% of our income for water. The county now wants to sell our water system to a private company, which could raise rates even higher. Many California communities are in a similar situation or worse. In 2012, California became the first state in the nation to adopt a human right to water policy, declaring that all humans have a right to safe, clean, affordable, and accessible water for drinking, cooking, and sanitation. In San Gerardo, we are using California's human right to water to turn the government policy into better practices. We have built closer relationships and alignment of values and goals with state and regional water board staff, who now support us in advancing our own community-based solutions.
Requiring state agencies to consider California's human right to water policy has opened the door to productive, if incremental, conversations and policy changes not previously possible. For example, in February, the State Water Board passed a resolution implementing the human right to water and instructing its staff to collect and publish critical data, include affected communities in developing solutions, and consider the human right to water policy in all its activities, including water rights proceedings. We call on the United States government to adopt the human right to water, as California has done, to align its values and goals, prioritize building capacity in communities like San Gerardo, and realize the sustainability and justice that can only come from community-led solutions based in democratic and human values.
Good afternoon. I am Tu Tran with Community Legal Services in Philadelphia, where I focus on utility issues. I speak today in support of a national water affordability standard. Over the last 12 years, I have represented elderly and disabled persons needing water to treat medical conditions and for basic sanitation. Parents with young children at risk of losing custody because of loss of water service. Families at risk of losing their homes to water foreclosures. And many, many people who have suffered months and even years without water service. In Philadelphia, we are lucky, though, to have a champion on water affordability, Councilwoman Sanchez, who succeeded in passing a city law in December 2015 that requires income-based affordable water bills. If properly implemented, customers will also receive earned forgiveness of arrears and protection from losing their homes to water foreclosure. Having a national standard would make our work not such a struggle. This standard should establish water bills based on monthly income from 2% for the lowest income to up to 4%, as recommended by experts on utility programs. Another utility best practice is providing earned forgiveness of water balances, giving low-income families a fresh start, as recognized by the US EPA through the Water Research Foundation. A national standard would guide the many US jurisdictions you've heard today that are also in dire need of affordability programs. We can continue to fight these battles family by family and city by city, or we can decide, as we should as a nation, to recognize water not only as a human need, but as a human right. Thank you.
Commissioners, 23,883 separate residential households suffered water shutoffs in 2015, affecting 64,000 residents in Detroit. They were all forced to live without water. Seniors, children, the disabled, even veterans, many for months at a time because they were all low-income people and unable to pay the ever-rising cost of public water. The notion that elected officials believe that they have the right to block entire neighborhoods from accessing clean municipal water and sanitation is vile and repulsive. Poverty connected to the loss of auto-related jobs is the tie that binds Detroit to these mass water shutoffs. A water affordability plan that formulates payments based on income as an alternative was offered over and over again, yet mass shutoffs continue. Privatizing public water is the ultimate goal, so we seek relief from new voices helping to shine a light on this privatization demon. The next round of mass water shutoffs began this month with an aggressive campaign of 400 to 500 residential shutoffs projected each week. The water crisis first appeared in the town of Highland Park, then it traveled to Detroit, and now Flint, Michigan has put water quality and access issues on the front pages everywhere. We believe that access to water is a human right and hope that this body of influential commissioners will find a way to help us standardize this message. I am Maureen Taylor, State Chair, Michigan Welfare Rights. And so, in closing, you have heard violations of the human rights to water and sanitation is a present and ongoing problem that communities in the United States face every day. Affordability, mass water shutoffs, criminalization, contamination, long-term health concerns related to lead, nuclear, and agriculture industries as communities continue to live without access to adequate and safe water and sanitation services. It is the government's responsibility to ensure that our water is adequate, safe, and affordable for all, and that everyone has access to sanitation. We call upon this Honorable Commission to urge the United States government to take full responsibility for its duty to respect, to protect, and to fulfill these human rights. This is not a duty that should be relegated to the private sector, because profit-making entities can never be the vehicle for providing a universal or a common good. UN human rights experts recently issued a very strong statement on the water crisis in Flint, and more broadly, the action needed by the United States government to guarantee the human right to water for every resident. The UN Special Rapporteur on Toxics sits in this audience today in full support of that statement. We hope that this commission recognizes the breadth of the issue and helps push the United States to recognize and address this critical problem. Accordingly, we invite this honorable commission to visit our communities to investigate this issue further and call upon the federal government to make executive policy solutions as a matter of extreme urgency. We thank you all.
Thank you very, very much for that. In fact, you're well within time. Thank you. Yes, the United States.
Distinguished commissioners, civil society friends, secretariat colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, again, my name is Mike Fitzpatrick. I'm the interim permanent representative of the United States to the Organization of American States. And I want to, first of all, welcome all those who have joined us here for this hearing. And I thank our colleagues from civil society for your presentations today on behalf of residents, citizens, and non-citizens alike from across these United States. As some of you may not know, this is the very first time that the United States has appeared before the Commission on the issue of access to water. And as such, the United States government has a significant delegation of both international and domestic experts working on the issue with us here today. So let me first start off by introducing Dr. Matthew McGrath from the U.S. Department of State, who will provide a brief international context for this issue, as well as identify some of the programs the United States is implementing with regards to the access to water around the world. Following Dr. McGrath, we have representatives from several domestic U.S. government agencies, led by the Environmental Protection Agency's Becky Clark, Deputy Director, Office of Groundwater and Drinking Water, the Department of Housing and Urban Development's General Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Office of Fair Housing and Equal Employment, Brian Green, and finally, from the Department of Health and Human Services, Indian Health Services, Captain Mark Calkins. We also have several visitors with us, observers from the Departments of Interior and Justice with us as well today. So first of all, colleagues, over to you, Dr. McGrath.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Matthew McGrath, and I am representing the U.S. Department of State. And first, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights for hosting this discussion today and bringing attention to this very important issue. Perhaps no two issues are more important to human health, sustainable economic development, and peace and security than the twin issues of water and sanitation. Some 663 million people currently lack access to an improved water source around the world. In this context, an improved water source just refers to the physical characteristics of the water source and says nothing about if the water is safe to drink. It's estimated an extra 2 to 3 times this number actually do not have access to safe drinking water. In addition, an estimated 2.5 billion people lack access to improved sanitation facilities. Lack of access to water, sanitation, and hygiene is linked to over 3.4 million deaths every year. Of these, 99% are located in developing countries. Overall, 4% of the global burden of disease could be prevented by improving water supply, sanitation, and hygiene. For diarrheal disease, the second leading cause of death in children globally, increased access to safe drinking water, sanitation, and hygiene can reduce incidence by up to 70%. The World Health Organization has estimated the global economic impact associated with inadequate drinking water and sanitation to be $260 billion annually, or 1.5% of the GDP of the country studied. Women and children are disproportionately affected by water and sanitation challenges. They usually bear the primary responsibility for meeting the water needs of the family, and as such, they have to forego their own economic and educational opportunities. Access to safe drinking water and sanitation improves childhood education for this very reason. School enrollment rates for girls have been shown to improve by over 15% when girls are provided with safe drinking water and a toilet facility, given that they no longer have to walk miles every day to fetch water for their families. The United States understands the right to safe drinking water and sanitation to be derived from the right to an adequate standard of living and inextricably related to the right to the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health, both rights enshrined in the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. As with all rights contained in or derived from this covenant, states' parties have an obligation to progressively realize these rights in accordance with Section 2, Paragraph 1. However, the United States is not a party to this covenant, and the rights contained in or derived from this covenant, including the right to safe drinking water and sanitation, are not justiciable in U.S. courts. Nor does the United States have an obligation to implement human rights instruments to which it is not a party. That said, the United States has long recognized the importance of this sector to global development, and we remain one of the world's largest donors in the water sector, investing in capacity building, infrastructure, technology, private sector engagement, and innovative financial instruments to mobilize local resources. With the passage of the Water for the Poor Act in 2005, Congress focused on access to safe drinking water and sanitation for developing countries as a specific foreign policy objective, requiring increased U.S. foreign assistance. More than 20 U.S. agencies now have water programs which operate internationally. The United States renewed its commitment to sustainably improve access to safe water and sanitation with the Water for the World Act in 2014. This act built on the Water for the Poor Act of 2005. The United States set a goal in its 2013 Water and Development Strategy to reach an additional 10 million people with improved water sources and 6 million people with improved sanitation by the year 2018. These targets are on track to be realized. In fiscal year 2014, the U.S. Agency for International Development allocated $352 million for water and sanitation-related projects overseas in 49 partner countries. In the same year, the Millennium Challenge Corporation, another U.S. foreign aid agency, allocated $290 million for water-related projects. From 2007 to 2015, almost 33 million people received access to improved drinking water, and over 16 million people received access to improved sanitation as a result of USAID projects. MCC's work on improved water systems benefits an estimated 8.7 million people, while work on improved sanitation benefits an estimated 2.3 million people. More than 20 other U.S. government agencies and departments continue to make contributions to address global water and sanitation challenges. For example, NASA invests several million dollars every year to support improved water management and currently has dozens of water-related projects ongoing around the globe. The U.S. Geological Survey has contributed hydrologic and other earth science data, analytical tools, and models for monitoring and analyzing streams and aquifers. This data supports water resource management decisions in Ethiopia, India, Pakistan, Indonesia, and other developing countries. Thank you, commissioners, for this opportunity today to demonstrate the importance of access to safe drinking water and sanitation as a U.S. foreign policy objective. And I will now turn to my colleagues who will expand on this issue in our domestic policies.
I would also like to thank the Commission and civil society for putting this topic before us today. Again, my name is Becky Clark from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency's Office of Groundwater and Drinking Water. The United States is not a party to the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, and therefore rights derived from the ICESCR, including the right to safe drinking water and sanitation, are not international legal obligations of the United States. However, the United States has joined consensus on the UN Human Rights Council's resolution on the human right to safe drinking water and sanitation. Domestically, the United States supports universal and non-discriminatory access to safe drinking water and sanitation, which are vitally important to human health and well-being. The United States Safe Drinking Water Act, SIDWA, is the main federal law that protects the quality of Americans' drinking water. The Safe Drinking Water Act authorizes and requires the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency to set national health-based standards applicable to public water systems for the provision of drinking water to protect against both naturally occurring and man-made contaminants that may be found in drinking water. SIDWA also protects the sources of drinking water through source water protection programs and a regulatory program to prevent underground injection, which endangers underground sources of drinking water. The U.S. EPA's role is to set national drinking water standards and ensure, with the states and tribes where they have primary enforcement authority, that the quality of water provided by public water systems meets those standards. The U.S. EPA also establishes minimum standards for underground injection control programs that are implemented by the states and EPA. Additionally, SIDWA requires states to create a source water assessment program for all their public drinking water systems. While EPA works collaboratively with the states and tribes to implement the Safe Drinking Water Act, the agency does not have jurisdiction over the administration or finances of public water systems. EPA does, however, provide technical assistance and training to promote sound financial management of public water systems. Since its inception in 1997, the Drinking Water State Revolving Fund has provided $30 billion in funds for more than 12,400 drinking water infrastructure projects, including drinking water treatment systems, pipes for transmission and distribution of water, and storage. Recent events in Flint, Michigan have increased awareness regarding our nation's drinking water. To ensure safe drinking water is returned to the residents of Flint, partners across the federal government, including the Department of Health and Human Services, FEMA, the Small Business Administration, EPA, HUD, and the Departments of Education and Agriculture are actively engaged in response efforts. Additionally, EPA issued an emergency order under Section 1431 of the Safe Drinking Water Act to ensure that Michigan and Flint immediately take actions necessary to protect public health. Under Section 1431A of SIDWA, the EPA administrator is authorized to take actions she deems necessary, including issuing emergency orders to protect the health of such persons if, one, there is information indicating an imminent and substantial endangerment to the health of persons from a contaminant in or likely to enter a public water system, and two, state, local, and tribal authorities have not acted to protect public health. EPA is also providing technical support to Flint, including assisting with sampling efforts to test different aspects of Flint's drinking water. Looking forward, EPA is taking the lessons we have learned from the drinking water emergency in Flint to conduct immediate actions to prevent this from happening again. EPA sent letters to governors and environment and public health commissioners in the states, which request actions to strengthen protection of our nation's drinking water. The letters outline specific steps to enhance oversight of the lead and copper rule implementation, and also to inform states of training, strategies, and approaches to assist states in understanding appropriate sampling techniques and steps needed to ensure optimal corrosion control treatment is in place. It also calls on states to work with EPA and other stakeholders to identify strategies and actions to improve the safety and sustainability of our drinking water systems. EPA is also working to update the lead and copper rule. We will carefully evaluate stakeholder input, national experience in implementing the rule, and the experience in Flint to develop a proposed rule in 2017. We expect to finalize the rule in 2018. EPA is committed to ensuring that water provided at the tap is safe for every American in the United States.
Thank you. My name is Brian Green. I'm with the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. I want to thank the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights for holding this hearing today. I'm going to speak some about HUD's role in addressing issues of water and sewer systems. The Department of Housing and Urban Development is committed to ensuring safe drinking water for everyone in the United States. The mission of HUD is to provide strong, sustainable, and inclusive communities and quality, affordable homes for all. Typically, in the United States, specific decisions regarding the provision of safe drinking water and sanitation are made at the local level. However, HUD does work to ensure safe drinking water in a number of ways. I want to briefly describe those ways. They fall in the general categories of provision of infrastructure to communities, the enforcement of federal civil rights laws regarding the provision of that infrastructure, and the regulation of lead-based hazards in housing. When it comes to infrastructure, the United States government, through HUD, provides $4 billion in community development and block grant funds to states and municipalities and other communities nationwide. Tens of millions of those dollars go to drinking water and sewer improvement. The same community development block grant fund provides a set-aside for the colonias, so that those communities are empowered to provide for safe drinking water and adequate sewer systems in border communities. Our enforcement role, specifically the role of my office within the Department of Housing and Urban Development, we're responsible for enforcing the Federal Fair Housing Act. The Federal Fair Housing Act prohibits discrimination on the basis of race, color, national origin, and other bases in all housing and housing-related transactions, which includes the provision of state and municipal services. So in instances where a state or a municipality denies basic water or sewer infrastructure to a community based on race, color, or national origin, that's an issue that my office addresses. Likewise, if a state or a municipality is providing upgrades to sewer or to water systems but denies those same upgrades to certain communities based on race, color, or national origin, that's an issue that my office addresses. Right now, we're actually working with some communities. Specifically, we are in Alabama looking at some issues there involving access to water. And we invite communities who are dealing with these issues, where they believe these issues are affecting populations or are based on certain populations or the demography of certain populations based on race, color, or national origin. We invite those communities to inform us of these circumstances so we can evaluate whether or not we can bring a Fair Housing Act enforcement action in those cases. And finally, HUD has an office that deals with lead-based hazards. And so just this past month, HUD delivered to the Office of Management and Budget a proposed rule to update its lead-based hazard regulation. And this proposed rule adopts the Center for Disease Control's 2012 definition of elevated blood levels for children under six. And this applies to HUD-assisted housing and other federally assisted housing. So that's the range of issues that we address at HUD. We do work closely with other federal agencies. So as situations arise and as there are allegations regarding certain communities or certain populations being denied access to water or to sanitation systems, we work together to determine how we may work best collectively to address them. Thank you.
I would also like to thank the Commission and Civil Society for putting this topic before us today.
Again, my name is Captain Mark Calkins, and I am with the Department of Health and Human Services, Indian Health Service. The Indian Health Service is an agency within the Department of Health and Human Services and is responsible for providing federal health services to American Indians and Alaskan Natives. The provision of the health services to members of the federally recognized tribes grew out of a special government-to-government relationship between the federal government and Indian tribes. This relationship, established in 1787, is based on Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution and has been given form and substance by numerous treaties, laws, Supreme Court decisions, and executive orders. The Indian Health Service is the principal federal health care provider and health advocate for the Indian people, and its mission is to raise the physical, mental, social, and spiritual health of the American Indians and Alaskan Natives to the highest level. In 1959, the Indian Sanitation Facilities Act, known as Public Law 86-121, authorized the Indian Health Service to provide essential sanitation facilities such as safe drinking water and adequate wastewater disposal facilities, along with solid waste facilities for Indian homes and communities. To raise the health status of the American Indians and Alaska Natives to the highest level, the Indian Health Service provides comprehensive primary health care and disease prevention services. The Sanitation Facilities Construction Program, we call it SFC. The SFC program is the environmental engineering component of the Indian Health Service health delivery system. In partnership with the tribes, the Sanitation Facilities Program provides the following services. We develop and maintain an inventory of sanitation facilities or sanitation deficiencies. We provide environmental engineering assistance and utility master planning and sanitary surveys. We develop multi-agency funded sanitation projects. We provide funding for construction of water supply and waste disposal facilities. We provide the professional engineering design and or construction services for water and wastewater disposal facilities. We provide technical consultation and training to improve the operation and maintenance of the tribally owned water supply and waste disposal facilities. We advocate for tribes during the development of policies, regulations, and programs. And lastly, we assist the tribes with sanitation facilities emergencies. In fiscal year 2015, the Indian Health Service provided just over 15,000 homes with adequate wastewater facilities, adequate water supply and wastewater facilities. However, at the end of fiscal year 2015, about 24,000 or 6% of all American Indian Alaska Native homes were without access to adequate sanitation facilities, and about 188,000 were approximately 47% of the American Indians and Alaska Native homes were in need of some form of sanitation facility improvements. Many of the 24,000 homes are in very remote locations, so it makes it very difficult to provide them with a sustainable water system. We currently have a backlog of 2,878 sanitation projects, and the cost to provide all American Indians and Alaska Natives with safe drinking water and adequate sewage systems to their homes is estimated to be just under $2.8 billion. Our annual budget appropriated to address this need is less than 4% of the total estimated need. In closing, the Indian Health Service is in consultation with tribes, continues to identify sanitation facility needs. The tribes and IHS will continue to collaborate with other federal agencies, states, and organizations to provide needed resources for these essential sanitation facilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Restricting myself time-wise, if I could just make certain comments and maybe ask some questions. I listened very carefully to all the submissions. And in relation, I don't think anybody's alive today who thinks and listens or reads any newspaper or news to who doesn't know about the generosity of the United States globally in helping poor countries and so on and so forth. But while she was speaking, Doctor, I couldn't help but think, I thank you for this assistance because I come from a small island, poor country. But I couldn't help but think, if you're doing that outside of your borders, can't you do it at the same time in tandem so that nobody falls through the cracks? It just hit me because I literally cannot understand the most powerful country in the world having this kind of stories about the lack of clean, potable water and sanitation. It really blows my mind, quite frankly. And it's not the picture I have of the United States. And I trust that all your agencies are going to work avidly on this because there should not be these gaps. There shouldn't be. You have your systems. What you said sounds fantastic, but they've fallen through the cracks. See? I cannot understand it, so I must be a little bit dumb. But I just wanted to mention this, that in relation to the most vulnerable groups, develop in societies because of either laws which were in place which were discriminatory, the practice of society which has gone on too long, or because of an underground, as it were, those undocumented immigrants and so on, and the homeless. These are the people who we have to reach out to, especially because if you ignore your most vulnerable, I am sorry to say it, I say quite bluntly, you are not a civilized society. You must protect the most vulnerable. And in doing so, you respect their human rights, recognize them as human persons, and give them back their dignity. This is what human rights is all about, giving people their dignity as humans. And I know the United States has the ability, has the facilities. You've just mentioned all of them. So I think there's something that's not quite meeting the needs, and this is what one has to do research about and then act upon, if possible. Now, I've talked too much. I'll call on my colleagues to deal with their various rapporteurships issues. Short.
Sí, short. bien corto. Pero siguiendo esta línea de pensamiento de la comisionada Margaret, mi preocupación sería, ¿hay limitaciones en el marco normativo? Es cierto, no se necesitan aprobar los convenios internacionales o los tratados en la materia específica para su cumplimiento. No debiéramos tener necesidad ni siquiera de ratificar convenios, porque la característica de los derechos humanos está en esa línea. Son innatos, nos pertenecen por la simple condición de nuestra humanidad. Pero, ¿cuál entonces es los retos que ustedes, frente a los avances que nos han planteado, en el marco reglamentario, normativo, interno, federal, estatal, para dar las respuestas a muy puntuales posiciones que nos han vertido los peticionarios en el día de hoy? ¿Cuál sería esa limitación o esa perspectiva de obstáculos o retos que tienen para una respuesta inmediata o una respuesta pronta a esta realidad?
Buenas tardes. Nuevamente, los representantes del Estado, a los representantes de la sociedad civil. Hay un aspecto que de entrada quiero destacar en criterio de la comisión, y tenemos que mirarlo desde el punto de vista de lo que son la normativa como fuente de obligaciones jurídicas internacionales. La declaración americana constituye una fuente de obligaciones jurídicas internacionales para todos los estados miembros de la OEA. Y ese aspecto es importante en la medida en que no solo desde el marco normativo, sino desde el marco de la jurisprudencia y del precedente internacional se ha señalado eso. Hace poco, precisamente, en un informe de fondo contra Canadá o sobre Canadá, se señaló precisamente por la Comisión cómo la declaración americana constituye una fuente de obligación legal internacional para todos los estados miembros de la Organización de los Estados Americanos al margen de la ratificación. Ahora bien, el aspecto que convoca esta audiencia se ha dicho como una oportunidad para promover un diálogo entre la Comisión, el Gobierno de Estados Unidos y la organización y las organizaciones de la sociedad civil en un tema específico, puntual, que es el del acceso al agua y cómo este acceso al agua se dice en el marco de la audiencia que afecta de manera desproporcionada a las minorías raciales en zonas urbanas, rurales, tribales, pero yo agregaría que no solamente a las minorías, sino a todos los seres humanos. El problema del agua es un problema de la humanidad entera. El carácter limitado de este recurso precisamente está haciendo que se desarrollen políticas en todos los estados, bajo todas las perspectivas de manejo, en un propósito común, y es conservar, proteger y desarrollar e impulsar el suministro de agua potable. Veo un aspecto y me parece muy bueno, que es una actitud positiva y muy receptiva a la búsqueda de fórmulas y prácticas que tiendan a materializar y a poner en ejecución el derecho humano al agua. Hay una realidad latente que están presentando un sector minoritario o un sector de los Estados Unidos, de la población, donde precisamente señalan la falencia y la preocupación y la afectación a los derechos humanos que viene tras la falta de agua potable. Pero igualmente se ve una actitud positiva en el gobierno de los Estados Unidos señalando una búsqueda en procura de paliar y dar una respuesta, y ojalá así sea.
Gracias. Gracias, Presidenta. También agradezco a los peticionarios, a la representación estatal, esta oportunidad. Como encargado de la unidad temática de derechos económicos, sociales y culturales, que también nombraremos ambientales, es claro que esa materia es muy importante. Es la tercera vez que tenemos oportunidad de un diálogo. Recuerdo que está en nuestra página de internet, en nuestro informe 2015, donde busquen en capítulo 4 un trabajo importante. Por la primera vez hicimos un informe sobre agua, con la contribución de Norma Coledani, de Susana y de otras personas de equipo, que ya utilizamos muchas de las informaciones. Pero tengo una pregunta, sí, y les pido que, con lo poco tiempo que tendrán, por favor no me dejen de contestar. Porque tuvimos una audiencia en octubre muy importante, pero con muchos países. En la noche anterior, una reunión con muchos de ustedes. I keep it Georgia on my mind. And, por la tercera vez, la palabra fracking no aparece. ¿Qué se pasa? Yo como comisionado recibo documentos, informaciones, fotos, y son 1,000,000,000 de litros de agua con tanques en una línea de 1,000 metros para ingestión con ratos profundos, con productos químicos y arena para la producción del shale gas. ¿Por qué no está incluido? ¿Será que la cuestión, esas denuncias son de alguna nación en competencia geopolítica con Estados Unidos que quiere causar danos? ¿O será que la conciencia de la sociedad civil norteamericana está muy, muy débil acerca del problema del fracking? ¿O yo, como comisionado, puedo estar errado? Me gustaría de tener una aclaración aquí. Y también, por último, en la reconocida pluralidad federativa de Estados Unidos, ¿por qué un estado tan importante como New York ya ha prohibido todo tipo de fracking? Entonces, por favor, con sinceridad, con fraternidad, esta pregunta, ¿por qué no aparece el tema de fracking? Hay un bloqueo, nos sentimos impedidos de discutir el tema, que es una cuestión ambiental también de importancia gigante. Gracias.
I'll ask the petitioners to answer first, but please, we are actually out of time. So,
Madam Chair, I will give a response, and it'll be brief, less than a minute. It is insulting to hear how the U.S. is providing water to the rest of the world when we are sitting right here in front of you. We need to hear about what the U.S. government will do for its own residents. The U.S. may not be party to ICESCR, but it does have an obligation to respect, protect, and fulfill the right to life under the American Declaration of Rights and the duties of man, as well as the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Additionally, the U.S. has signed ICESCR and therefore must not take steps that contravene the spirit of the treaty. As the gentleman from the State Department pointed out, a lack of access to safe, affordable, and adequate sanitation threatens the right to life as well as its broader formulation, the right to dignified life in multiple ways. Our delegation has presented stories from across the country to show how the U.S. has failed to uphold this the most fundamental of human rights and its obligation to its most vulnerable residents, and the government's presentation today unfortunately reflects its continued indifference to our plight. The federal government, by pointing fingers at state and local governments, yet it has taken no meaningful action to provide adequate, safe regulatory oversight, as preventable tragedy in Flint has illustrated, and it has conditioned receipt of federal funding for state water programs to meet these minimum human rights standards. Despite this disappointing reality, we reiterate our conditioned willingness to collaborate with the U.S. government to make the changes that we so desperately need. We hope that this honorable commission will join us in calling for the United States to recognize its obligation to the concrete action to resolve this crisis as a matter of urgency. Thank you, Madam Chair.
The state, please.
Thank you, Madam Commissioner. If I may just very briefly, several of you had raised questions about limiting factors, what is slowing the speed of responsiveness. I will note that, as was just mentioned, this is indeed the federal government that is representing the United States here today. We do not have state or local officials with us, partly because of the time involved, the limited amount of time in advance for preparing for today, but also, as the commissioners know, it is part of our makeup as a federal state. Certain responsibilities fall first to local and state officials, but we're also always willing to have them join us at the commission, as was some of you may have remembered from this morning. We also had one of the U.S. territories here as well. But I think that also goes to one of the questions that the commissioner raised with regards to the issue of fracking. Some of that is exactly as was just mentioned. That is first and foremost state and local issues before federal, number one. Number two, we do have systems in place where people are able to bring those concerns forward, and it doesn't necessarily start or stop at the federal level. There are many state and local layers that must be pursued first, in particular on the issue of fracking. With that, my colleagues, if you have something else to add, I know we're very short on time.
Yes, I'd also like to add on to your comment about the challenges. We are at the federal government administering the Federal Safe Drinking Water Act. And of course, that's national rules that we develop and oversight of the states and tribes who have primacy over drinking water systems. However, we very much hope to learn lessons from the crisis in Flint, Michigan, and learn where we can improve our oversight and our relationship with the states as we move forward.
Speak to us, and we can tell you where you can learn those lessons and speak to the
representatives. Madam President, I have a response on the on the issue of fracking, to Commissioner Vannucchi, we are present here today. There are members from California, from Pennsylvania, and elsewhere. We chose not to address that directly. I will say to the respondents that the Federal Clean Water Act does prohibit discharges of particular contaminants that are dangerous to human health. And in fact, the federal government has been complicit in shielding the fracking fluid constituents from public disclosure. They do have a responsibility to address those issues, which are not being done well in California, where our coalition is from. There are unlined pits that are the recipient of fracking fluids, and that is a subject of much contention in California. But the federal government does, in fact, have a responsibility to respond.
Could I ask you, as Commissioner Vannucchi mentioned that it hasn't been dealt with before, so could you send us a note on that, please?
We would be happy to do so.
Yes. Before I close, can I just make mention of the fact that this body is very happy and honored that the special rapporteur from the UN is here today and has been here throughout this hearing. It demonstrates the intent of both the global body and this regional body to work in cooperation and in close collaboration in all these issues of human rights, which are problematical all over the world. We welcome you and we thank you. Thank you. I think we have dealt with this matter as best as we can at this hearing, but if there's any issue that you wish to submit more information, please send them to us. We will be very happy to have those for our consideration with the other commissioners. Thank you.